It's today, EVE Online, February 1st, 2020. It's an unusual show because it's Saturday. I'm Matt Earl here with Lichgrave. What's up, Lichgrave?
Hey, happy first month of the year.
Yep. He's a guy who looks into markets with us. Always interesting. A couple other guys hanging out with us. Roliat.
Hello.
And Z-Master.
Hey, everybody.
All right. Talk as much as you want or as little as you want. First thing we're going to do, though, is just look at these packs in a little more detail and then talk a little bit about market stuff. It is unusual. It is a Saturday. We normally were just weekdays, but why not? So we're also contending with the, looks like possibly the end of DDoS attacks for EVE Online. For the last 5 days, there have been a series of attacks that have created a massive amount of disconnects, which makes the game unplayable. Let's actually tackle that for just a second. Z-Master, you were saying, what's your strategy against these DDoS attacks?
I wasn't saying anything.
Yes, you were. You said, I just log in, try to get my...
Oh, yeah, I was talking about... Well, I'm one of the fortunate ones that... some people, when they try to connect, they basically are blocked from connecting, you know, especially if you're in the US. But I live in the EU. So I'm one of those fortunate ones that connects. There is an initial error message, but then I just click on the X, and then I click on the connect button in the bottom, and then I'm still able to connect. But still, you only stay online for about 5 to 10 minutes before the system kicks you out. So I just tried to connect really quick and really quick go do my skilling spree kill so I get the free SP. Uh-huh. And after that, I just don't care about it and I go play something else, to be honest.
But you get in there, you get your prize for the day, and then you take off.
Yeah.
Or after that, it's all gravy. It doesn't matter what happens.
Yeah, after that, it doesn't matter what happens. But you know me, I'm AFK player. I play with the markets. So it doesn't really require me to be online all day to, you know, make those profits.
Yeah. Cool. And Roliat, you were saying the same thing?
Yeah. Right now, I'm having problems even getting the authenticating to finish up and go through the bulk data stuff. So I can't even get in to finish my skilling spree at the moment.
Well, a lot of people were getting confused that they couldn't get into the game when they actually could. Z-Master, you pointed out how to do it, and I had been doing it, but I didn't realize other people didn't know. How do you get into the game?
Well, I remember because every time at downtime, the launcher allows you to log in before you can actually connect to the game itself. So I know this from, like, you know, from veteran experience, let's call it like that. Like, at downtime, many times you're able to launch your client, the launcher I'm in, and then you launch the client, but the server is not online, so it puts you in in the old client connecting window, if you remember when we used to log in into the X file, if you remember those times. Basically, you can stay in that window indefinitely, and then just click on the connect button in the bottom, and whenever the service comes back up, it allows you to connect to the server itself.
Talking about that old launcher, right? Because the new launcher is this little window that comes up. Also, they got a CCP logo now that comes up. I think that's new. So you have this
transparent watermark.
Yeah, the watermark comes up, which is totally different than what they used to do 5 years ago, where they're saying, we're just getting the company out of your way. This is about the player. So our branding is going to be in the background. Well, it looks like that whole strategy went away with CCP Seagull, and now they're putting that brand back in your face, saying, this is CCP, we bring you good stuff. So you have this new logo. Bad time to release it, by the way, because people are looking at it thinking, like, I'm kind of upset with CCP right now, so I don't really like your brand right now. But anyway, that's just timing. You see a CCP logo, then you see the launcher, and then when you click your account, it actually opens a second launcher, and that's the actual launcher that gets you into the game. And that used to be how you got into EVE. There was no CCP logo. There was no launcher that launches different clients. There was just the client that would launch. And what was interesting about it is that's where every expansion, that launcher would change with different music in the background and a whole different piece of art. And then when you click connect on that, then it takes you into the game that has your character select screen. So Anyway, so if you have the launcher that comes up and basically says, yeah, I can't connect, just move that aside. And the launcher, the old launcher, as you were saying, click on that one that says connect, and that should get you into the game. It's really, there's just not a lot of information coming out from CCP that is making this very clear. I think they want it to go away, or they're working to make it go away so they don't have to make an explanation. But at this point, it's been 4 days. I think now they has kind of cleared up. Have you guys noticed that, or is it still in trouble?
Oh, there's still a big trouble. Like, I just launched the game. I just connected into the game, and it's lagging a lot. The chat is broken. It's not working at all. I keep getting a pop-up saying, oh, there was an error loading the chat. Please retry the connection to the port XXX whatever. And, yeah, I don't think this is ending at all, to be honest.
This is up from like a couple days ago where we hit what 32 people on server on Tranquility. So I mean, it got bad.
Well, it's at 30,000 now.
Numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we're back up. I mean, so you know, it's not terrible, but yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, though, that is a bit low for. Let's have a look. We're supposed to be at this point. We're in what? End of January, in the middle of a weekend, this is peak performance for EVE Online as far as players in the game, right? PCU should be at its highest point for the year because literally this is when players play the most, at the end of January, beginning of February. And this is also a weekend, which is the heaviest use of EVE Online is during the weekend and usually European time zone. If we look... compare it historically. Go ahead. What were you going to say?
Let me just double check. Well, so this weekend is the Super Bowl, so...
Tomorrow, though, right? I don't...
Yeah, but, you know, people who are making the trip, you know, to wherever. So, if, you know... So, I mean, it is a bit of an eventous...
Yeah.
Eventful weekend.
Well, this is encouraging because yesterday got up to, I think it peaked, 36,000, which is pretty strong numbers considering. Because normally, like pre-blackout was 31, but that is summer. So same time last year, let's go put a few years on the board here. I'll zoom in so you guys can see that a bit better. This is EVE Offline. If you've never seen it, this is where you can see some statistics. They're not completely indicative of the health of EVE Online, but it's a good way to kind of get an idea of how many people are participating in this virtual world. I do hate the way it works, though, I have to say, as much as I appreciate it. This huge mountain here, it was when EVE Online created alphas, basically free accounts. And so you got a major push up into the 50,000s, which we haven't seen since 2014. For those that don't know, I'll just open it up. That's 2008 through 2020. And as you can see, there's huge peaks and valleys here. All that is what we look back at and see. You know, 2010 through 2014 is kind of a golden era for MMOs. Since then, MMOs in general have fallen. EVE has sustained. And then in 2016 here, they made it free to play, and you can see that giant spike of players, and then that so slowly drifted down again to basically what our normal is for the last few years, which is right around 30 to 40,000 players. And that after blackout seemed to dip really hard. Again, this is summer, so it does go down, but summer didn't go down. The summer before didn't go down as far as this last summer, so... It does tell you that it was a bit worse than usual, down to like 30,000, 29,000, 30,000. Just think about it; it's not that many. It looks worse on the graph, but today and recently, it's back up to 36,000, which is a seasonal norm. Again, if we look back at last year, it was about 38,000, 40,000. So we're very close to that. Now, if we look at the actual week to see like how bad these DDoS attacks are hitting. Try to get in as narrow as I can. Yeah, you can see just, I think that's as close as I can get. I'll have to refresh to get closer. Oh, here, 36 hour. Let's go to 1 week. Let's start at 2 weeks. Okay, so we have some, get those fly ups. I can't use my mouse, but you can see on the left part of that graph, there is a certain consistency to the cycle. It peaks at right around 2 hours from now, slowly declines for the rest of the day and then downtime, and then it starts going back up. And so that has a consistent wavelength, essentially, until you get here to the last, since the 27th. We'll say that's like 4 or 5 days. And you can just see a terrible distortion to the normal wavelength, and that is completely interrupted gameplay due to denial of service attacks. I think they're either distributed or something. I don't know what the first D is for, but so that's what you have. And if we look at the 36-hour mark, even the last day or so, you can see how ragged the participation has been. It's not a smooth curve. It's got a lot of jagged little points in it, and probably from certain sectors of people dropping off or getting clipped, because you don't normally see people log off in big amounts at the same time. Even when a big fleet is over, you're still losing a few hundred people. But when you see drops like you're seeing at the beginning of this loop, that is a mass disconnect of quite a few people. Say 36. Can I go back? Yeah. See, it's much smoother over here. Yikes. I've lost my way. So it's much smoother in general. And this, you can see there's massive drops and, oh, it just looks ugly. My God. It's like looking at a distortion of some sort. Okay. So anyway, that's what CCP has been, distributed. I've heard different things, but I thought it was distributed denial of service, which basically means lots of people are, lots of people are slamming a server. They're trying to connect to it, basically crowding out all other connections. It's like a virus that takes over more territory than it needs. I'll take your word for it. Distributed denial of service, DDoS attacks is what we call those. And you guys have been managing, though. You get in there, right? You guys in here in this room, you guys managed to get your SP?
Yeah, I'm able to get in. I haven't had a single bit of issue. It's certain parts of the country, certain parts of the world, I guess, that are being affected more than others.
Yeah, just to make it clear, this isn't like something that is like, it's not CCP that is personally being targeted or anything. This is actually a global thing. It mostly affects North America and the northern part of Europe. So because EVE is located in London, that's what's being affected. Now, I'm not sure what they are attacking in general. I don't know if it's the data center, whatever it is. But it's not EVE directly, because I play many other online games that also have servers in London, in Amsterdam, and then in the US, in Virginia, which is one of the biggest distributors in the US, and they are all having issues: connection issues, authentication issues, login issues, server stability. Everything is broken, and this is not just EVE. EVE Online, Escape from Tarkov is also having the same issues. Like, this is not a personal attack on one company itself. It's an attack on the entire network itself, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. And this comes at a time when real-life politics are a real-life current events. I wouldn't call them politics, but real-life current events. Some incredibly, I would call, historic things are happening. For instance, you have Brexit actually kicking in. And so that's why I think yesterday when we were talking about this, it was like the Remainers are attacking. So people are being upset about Britain leaving exiting the European Union are causing problems, especially in England.
I wouldn't.
There's no way to know.
There's no way to know. And I don't want to get too much political, but if I had to guess, given how Russia and Iran are one of the biggest superpowers in terms of hackers mm-hmm. in the world. Like they have the most hackers, they have the best hackers in the world. I would say that this is more about what happened between the U.S. and Iraq.
And Iran, you know, yeah.
With the assassination thing, with the political assassination, I would assume this is related with that more than Brexit, you know.
If you had to attach it to some sort of political move,
it would be the Iran thing.
Yeah,
but there's no way to know.
But there's no way to know.
That is complete tinfoil. So
yes, complete tinfoil, complete assumptions, nothing concrete.
There have been indications that this is a multi-pronged attack against multiple gaming communities, potentially to extract.
Yeah, well, we just mentioned that.
Yeah,
it also seems, based on what I was observing, that certain transit providers are being affected more than others, obviously. And theoretically, if you had the ability to push your traffic through another endpoint or through another provider, TCP might be able to mitigate it. But the problem is they need that anti-DDoS service, which means all of their routes are being given to someone else to advertise, and someone else has to manage the routes back into their network, essentially. It kind of sucks to see it because, like, I do this for a living. And it's pretty obvious that some people in Europe are not being affected because they take a completely different path in.
Yeah.
But some VPN providers, for example, are working fine. When I connect to my VPN provider in Amsterdam or into Spain, I log in immediately and I have no lag at all. But if I try to connect from North America, I'm completely screwed.
So you have heard from Fonsway a few seconds ago, and then this latest talker was Minton Benedal. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
So you do this for a living?
Yeah, I'm a network administrator. I've worked at a couple of small ISPs and a couple of multinationals.
Yeah.
And it's typically, if you're hosting any website, you're going to use a CDN, a content distribution network. And at that point, your website will either be hosted on their servers or cached on their servers, or you'll have their traffic for your video game going through their network. And they just have a very large and extensive network that's supposed to be able to mitigate these sorts of attacks. However, some of the biggest attacks have taken down the biggest CDNs before. And there's usually a retrospective analysis provided after attacks like this we see on a global scale. So it'll be interesting to see from my perspective after this is over. But unfortunately, CCP has no control over what the CDN does. So it kind of sucks for everyone at the moment.
They're a boat on this river, right?
Well, let's just be very clear about what can be attacked and where and when. So I also do this for a job. So right now, services like API, account management, and chat are all hosted in Amazon Cloud Compute, Amazon EC2. Tranquility itself, the game servers, all the database, all the login process, everything that relates to the game client is doing is talking directly to the Lynx data center in London, which houses the Tranquility physical equipment that's owned and operated by CCP along with their routers. Now, the CDN can be attacked. As we've seen, chat hasn't been working. You've probably seen, couldn't connect to, the live.chat.evonline.com. That message has popped up a lot because 5222 is XMPP chat, and that is hosted in Amazon, and that's what's currently being attacked.
Oh.
Previously, when we get disconnected from the game, that's not CDNs. That's not the internet being attacked. That's CCP directly, unless there's a different pattern of attack. Some users disconnect, other ones don't. But if everyone disconnects simultaneously, or at least not everyone, but not with any geographical necessarily rhyme or reason, disconnecting from the game means that the most faster inside the actual CCP data center was being attacked at that particular moment. Since we haven't seen those particular disconnects recently, we've seen mostly the chat stuff, it stands to reason that the CDN is what's under attack at the moment.
What does that tell us about?
If you look at the
this is Aria.
Over the whole world, you'll see that there's three countries that are mostly getting hit. It's the US, it's the UK, and to a lesser extent, but still being attacked is Laos, which is having its own things in the news. And the thing that unites these three countries is there's something political going on in all three countries. I'm not up on the Laos stuff because being in the U.S., my news is dominated entirely by the impeachment hearings. But all three of those countries do have something going on politically. All three are also from, if you look at the Google attack vectors in terms of where the DDoSs are targeted, it's those three countries.
Right. And have we heard of these attacks having any sort of synchronicity with any sort of attack on anything that's not a game?
I haven't personally, but there has been quite a bit of media attention given to, I believe it was Ubisoft, and I believe there was another developer as well that wants to start civil actions against DDoSers, which, depending on how they figure out who the hell's doing it, might be a little more complicated. But they might be a little bit riled up because there is an active campaign against them by a multinational gaming company at the moment. So that's, again, tinfoil, just as much tinfoil as the Iran speculation.
Right.
But it's a guess.
So I was speaking when I mentioned the fact that I haven't heard about any attacks on any services that are not games, I was speaking to the potential allegation that this is politically motivated, because a politically motivated attack wouldn't limit itself to games.
Yeah, you would also attack government infrastructures and stuff like that.
So there's a mix of clues here, but I do like the way you separated out when the game crashes versus when the services crashes that are associated with the game. That is interesting to know. Now there is we have over 30,000 players playing EVE Online, so the game is up and running. So if CCP was being attacked directly, that seems to not be happening at this moment.
Yeah.
Right. And yesterday I didn't get any game disconnects either, and the day before, the only game client itself appear to be related to Amazon, as in the launcher is supposed to pass authentication information automatically to the client, and that has been failing because that goes through Amazon. So what happens is you hit the button on the launcher that fires up the client loads up, gives you an error message, says it couldn't connect, and then you just click that straight in because the game client can talk to the game server. But the launcher wasn't able to get that auth token passed all the way through.
So yeah, and that might be your individual experience, but I've been actually reaching out and trying to talk to Alliance mates and other people I've known who play EVE, and that is one problem. I think we're looking at a multifaceted issue.
Oh, that's a common experience. It's not just mine.
Yeah. Sorry, that's not what I was suggesting. My bad. What I am also seeing, though, is people are still having lag inside of the game as well, depending on what transit provider they're taking to connect to the CDN, which still seems to be a problem. Looks like GTT in particular, still seems to be a problem. But
just to clarify, a CDN attack will not impact the game. What would impact the game is route attacks that are not involved with CDNs or attacks directly on the router cluster itself at links.
Well, no offense. It may not be an attack. I'm just identifying that there seems to be a problem on a particular path where people who are connecting to the game, who get past the step one connection issue, are having a secondary problem where the input to the actual your command inputs to the game and everything server side, everything being communicated back from the server is delayed by like 20 to 30 seconds, or ultimately you just get disconnected. It's still happening for some people, but it's a limited scale as well. And it may or may not be related to the DDoS. It's just when these kinds of problems happen, you'll have other issues crop up as they do in day-to-day life and operations. And it might be multifaceted. So it gets messy.
Yeah, and just before François, and that's what we're seeing, those secondary effects. If you're in the U.S., you have very, very different experience depending on where you live in the U.S., where people live on the West Coast, the middle of the U.S., Canada, they're experiencing some issues, but largely they're able to get in. If you live in the Southeast U.S., you have a very different experience. You're passing two areas of attack, and the combination of that makes it really grueling. People trying hours to log in just to finally get in and being disconnected 2 minutes later. That's what the people from the Southeast US are reporting, as opposed to if you have an alliance mate in Iowa or in Washington or in Canada, they say, no, once I'm in, I'm pretty good.
All right. Well, we're not going to solve it, but it's nice to understand it a little bit better. And we're going to close this part of the conversation and we'll revisit it Monday if it's still going on.
I did want to clarify one final thing. We've been talking about server lag, and I've heard a few people mention, you know, here and there that the servers, but I really want to clarify that, like, the servers are fine. The issue is getting to and from them. If the servers were being hit themselves, like, for instance, even the login server is not being overloaded by all of us logging in all at once after a disconnect, because they handle that every single day. Tranquility is up to 20,000 users within moments. So the servers are not overloaded. If there were server performance issues, we would actually start seeing tie-dye. So the issues are entirely network related.
Yeah, they're connection issues, not server issues. That's good to understand. All right, actually, you guys stick around. We're going to talk about Silver Pack and Bronze Pack and Gold Pack and all the packs that have come out. What do you guys think about that? I'm going to throw it to Lichgrave first, and then we can distribute the conversation. Also, I'm going to go ahead and turn off my camera because I have got to do some things and turn off this bright light. So I will disappear for a minute, but we're still going to talk about this stuff for a few minutes.
Yeah, so we had the new packs introduced a few days ago, replacing the old packs. Bronze pack being 60 plex, some expeditionary suits, some skins, and the 250,000 skill points. This was the skill point change that everybody was going up in arms about. I believe the original starter pack was like $5 for a million SP, and now it's down to 250 across the board, regardless of which one you purchase. Each one gives you some new bonuses, or some basically bigger bonuses, different skins, more plex, more game time. So it's really interesting to see how this kind of played out. A lot of people are complaining that these packs aren't worth it as much as the old ones used to be. I didn't personally go through every single of the original packs, so I can't tell you exactly what the 100% differences are, but I do know the SP was a big one. So it's interesting, to say the least. I know a lot of people were complaining about the SP in it all, but I don't know. I'm kind of indifferent to it. It was weird. The SP, the thing with the SP is I didn't see a problem with it. I could kind of understand the argument of some broken promise made years ago, but yeah. Overall, I think the packs are more expensive, and this is, I think, what people are really getting at, is the packs are more expensive, but they give less overall in comparison to the older packs. But I don't know exactly what the older packs had, so if somebody who has purchased them, maybe...
Don't forget the reason, sorry to interrupt you, but the reason why they are more expensive is because they also give you Omega Time. They not only give you Plex, which we know that 500 plex costs $15, give or take, but they also give you Omega Time. That's why they are expensive. You got one pack, it gives you 30 days, another pack gives you 60 days, another pack gives you 3 months.
So did the old pack used to just give plex? Is that right?
I'm not sure.
That's
think
kind of the problem.
It also gave you Omega Time, but it was 7 days, if I'm not mistaken. I may be mistaken, but I think it was 7 days.
The top pack was 3 months, I believe.
Okay. So the top pack currently is also 3 months.
I mean, I was one of those people that bought the starter pack for $5. And got his, 1 million SP for free, basically. Well,
yeah.
Not free, but close enough.
So, I mean, looking at this in particular, the top pack, it used to be you got 3 months, you've got two multiple character training certificates, and I believe you got some skins remember or correctly, as well as some Plex.
Multiple character trainers, those were, like, from what I remember on the market, those things were almost as much as 500 Plex. Close, but not exactly.
You also got, no, it was extractors. Extractors, I believe. You got 5 extractors.
Okay.
So they changed it, and now it's just straight SP.
Yeah, but the SP doesn't increase on the package. It simply is just a 250 skill point flat, regardless of which one you purchase.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So.
What changes, depending on the pack, is the amount of Plex that you receive and the amount of a Megaton that you receive.
There's also certain, the skins change, because like you actually get ship skins in the silver, gold, and platinum, and then the bronze gives you the expeditionary suit and a couple of low-level skins, like the chromodynamic skin. Whereas the higher end gives you things like the Dracovec metamateria, and then like, yeah, the Triglavian, basically the metamateria skins. Those are the two higher-end ones.
You mentioned earlier that some people were making a fuss about it, and the thing that people are making a fuss about is the fact that you can basically buy the cheapest pack and get your 250,000 skill points, and then you do a character transfer to another account, and then you can buy it again. But I'm not sure, you know, if that is actually worth doing, given the fact that the character transfer costs 500 Plex.
I thought it was gated at one per account.
Yes, it's one per account.
So
but if
you move the character to another account,
You can use it again.
Yeah, but transferring a character costs you a bunch of
500 Plex.
It's 500 Plex. Yeah, so it's crazy. Yeah.
So that's why I was going to say next that people that are saying that you can transfer character and then buy it again. Why would you do that? You would waste so much money.
It's literally cheaper to, or actually, would it have been cheaper? Hold on, because let me think about it.
I think
$5 for the original pack.
Some math has to be worked out.
So I think it was still viable to pay the $5 because two skill extractors is a 1.6 billion, which is a little over 700 Plex or something like that.
But it takes time to transfer a character, too, so you're losing the time.
I'm sorry
to cut you off, but this is not a plan. No, it's theoretically, it might work on paper.
Yeah.
It doesn't work in practicality.
Yeah, no. It is kind of ridiculous. I think the real problem was during the bug where you could purchase it multiple times. So you could pay $50 and then get a character that has 50 million skill points. 25 million skill points. So, you know, so it's...
I can see that as a problem.
That's kind of a... I can see that as a problem. At the same time, though, you're still paying money. But that is cheaper overall than what it would cost to do that. Doing large skill injectors, so I can see that as being a problem. But that was patched. That was patched ages ago, and so this newly brung disdain towards the SP system. It's just old water, really. It's stale at this point.
Yeah, I think it's two issues. I think the old pack had that. You look at the money. You look at the amount of SP. I think CCP has made an adjustment here. They lowered the SP, increased the cost of the pack. Maybe it's not financially worth it to exploit it in that manner. But I think that the real issue is the betrayal of trust among the players. If CCP had taken a stance saying, we're not going to create SP out of nothingness and sell it. And when, it looks like we've gone back on that.
When did they make that promise?
I was looking for... the actual source, like an article. I couldn't find one personally, but although I didn't spend a lot of time looking, but I did see a screenshot in the CSM Discord where a statement from CCB about skill points.
I think that promise,
I don't know how old it was.
I think that promise came like years ago. We're talking like 2014 from Fozzy, who said something, and I'm totally just doing this from memory, so it could be wrong, but a game designer will say, saying, yeah, yeah, we'll never do that sort of a thing. And that may have been the plan.
Marketing, though.
That may have been the plan back then, but we're 6 years from that promise, 5-6 years from that promise in a digital age.
And not just that, it's we're six years, one developer and a completely new company, because this is not CCP LLC or GMB or whatever their corporate structure. This is Pearl Abyss CCP. It's like Activision Blizzard. This is Pearl Abyss CCP. This isn't just CCP. So,
and that's an excellent point, because we know the marketing division is different from the developers. We learned from Blackout, one of the comments made is the way this company is structured now, the marketing department creates these packs and these campaigns and is separate from game development. I think it's good that they've adjusted amounts to make it less of an exploit. I think that helps with that concern. But I still think that's where people are kind of hung up on a statement made years ago from a stance where the company is going to not sell SP free. Right?
I think things
have changed.
All right. I do think it's a tall order to hold somebody accountable for a promise made 6 years ago. Different players were promised that. Different developers were the ones that promised that, probably. And a different company backing it were the ones that promised that. And to say that can't change over a period of 5 years in a world where things are changing constantly and methods and practices of competitors is changing practically is just not, doesn't seem fair to the company to strap them down to something they said at a time when it may have been okay to say that sort of thing. On the other hand, the reason that people might get upset about this is because this game is about long-term investment. Your thoughts?
Yeah, exactly that. I mean, a company, year to year, each company has to go through budgets, they have to go through earnings, things change year to year. And given the amount of SP we get from just logging in or not logging in, logging to your character select and clicking a button, I've gained 250,000 SP just from logging in 3 days in a row or whatever the last one was. I think the value, it's less of an issue in terms of fairness, but I think it's a customer relations issue where CCP didn't come out ahead of us, ahead of these packs and talk to anyone. I think that's a common issue or a common trend we see with CCP is they go a little radio silent. Maybe they offend some of their players, and then, you know, we get upset about it, and then maybe CCP has to do damage control.
I think there's also fear about what the future could hold. Because at the moment, I mean, SP is created over time, just naturally, right? Let's just assume someone's Omega. They just they generate SP over time automatically. If you want to buy an injector or sell an injector, you have to actually pay real money or a Plex to buy the extractors and then sell that SP. But with CCP coming in and selling SP directly, even though right now it's not the most economical way to buy SP, it certainly looks like a bit of creep into what into more selling of SP directly, and that could destabilize an entire portion of our economy. So that being said, it's a monetization avenue that they seem to be interested in pursuing, but we've obviously already invested a lot of ISK and real money into our skill farms, if you have any, or to keep our accounts plexed. And as long as extractors are sold on the market, though, people shouldn't be fear. I think it's an overreaction, because at the end of the day, you can still pull that SP out.
I think people are afraid of what it can be and not what it is. So I don't think people are afraid of these packs. I think people are afraid of what the slippery slope of what the future might bring. The for a lack of better terms, the pay-to-win concept of the WoW player that starts to play WoW, pays Blizzard, you know, $50 or $30 or whatever it is, and gets a fully leveled up character, right? That's what people are afraid of.
Are we getting into gold ammo territory here? Because if we are, that's great. I'm willing to talk about it.
I think people are afraid of the slippery slope of the pay-to-win, right? And us that have been playing the game for more than 10 years, that have that not just social and time investment, you know, like, we don't want to see the game, I don't know, become easy.
So I think that there's a multifaceted thing to this. Yeah. I've been using that word a lot today. number one, if we're talking about, let's just quickly on the economic thing, the damage has already been done because we all saw what Plex was, the price to Plex an account was a few months ago before blackout. The damage as far as skill injectors was already done. That's already there. So, but on the other hand, so the second thing is you have SP, which means nothing. This is just skill points that enable somebody to do something. The argument being that I have suffered to get these skill points, so you should, because that's only fair or whatever. I mean, that's been gone since skill injectors. What the important thing is these social links that we do, because that's the whole point of Eve is the social interaction. That's the whole point of the sandbox. And so, and that doesn't take away from your, that is what really defines your character, because you have skill farms generating hundreds of millions of SP, right, every year, and throwing it onto the market, and those characters never interact with the, with, you know, with
the community,
with anything, right? So I disagree entirely on the concept that the skill points make the character what it is. The player and the player's interactions is what makes the character what it is. The skill points are just the enabler. As far as the future of, you know, being able to pay money to get a fully fleshed out character, that's still been a thing. That's been a thing since the skill injectors. You just have to go through skill injectors. I forget who got every single skill in the game just through skill injectors. Paid lots of money for
Iron
it.
Livingston.
I think it was.
Oh, it was actually Iron Bank. Iron Bank did that publicity stunt.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you want to talk about pay to win? There you go. even, you know, so.
Yeah, but like it.
But it does nothing. It does nothing. What? Who is Iron Bank aside from the guy who spent all the money to get the SP? Exactly.
To get publicity for a show that he was doing anyway. To get more ISK, it's a cycle, right? If we did that,
exactly,
we could do that too, right? We do all kinds of in-game publicity stunts to make talking in stations more popular, and it's a cycle. That's the only thing you can really spend your money on.
Right. In exactly. The game. So I think the SP, the whole SP thing is kind of. You know, I think it's dry, it's run its course, it's kind of ridiculous at this
point.
In
this day and age, yes, I fully agree with you. Like, Eve is 17 years old. There are active players, there are countless active players with more than 200 million skill points. SP means nothing in this day and age. And this is one of the reasons why I say, 17 years later, not 10 years ago, but now, in this era, I say that whenever a new player creates a new character, he should be given certain core skills at level 5 for free, right out of the bat. So they don't have to wait 6 months of training before they can do
something important. They don't have to wait at all. They can pay money and buy skill points, and that's why that will never change.
This is... This is Brule K. Welcome to the show, Brule.
Bruler's my name. I need to change that, actually.
Oh, Bruler.
It's a business, right? It's a business, right?
but it does lead into the other thing where before it was a player who's two players who start the game, both have Omega. Well, this is before Alpha Clones, right? Before Skillin. They'll both be at the same SP point if they log in and train, but one continues to play the game. Now, the person who continues to play the game and the other person who just logs in, the guy who actually comes in and plays and makes the ISK will actually have more SP at the end. So there's reward for playing the game through progression in the character, so on and so on. And we can keep going at this for hours. But yeah,
we can. Yeah.
All right.
You know. I think the campaign, if you think of it from a starter, then the starter's packs, and you think it's targeted to new players, this makes sense. You see this in other games where you would try out a game and say, I like this game, I'm going to start paying it or buy the game. And then you have maybe the standard pack and the deluxe pack. And what do you get in the deluxe pack? You get some cosmetics, and maybe you get something that helps you jumpstart your game time. Maybe it's some
XP
money, XP boost, or something of that nature. I think that's what they're trying to emulate here. And sure, you could buy skill injectors. There's other ways you can get the skill points. But for a new player who doesn't have that knowledge and just wants to, I like this game, I want to spend money and get the deluxe pack, that this meets that type of player. And I think that's what they were aiming at with that. And by aiming at those players that are maybe just starting the game, they maybe ignored how veterans might see these packs and react to it.
Well, they shouldn't have to. They shouldn't have to take us into account. They're new players. You know, our opinion shouldn't even matter on that. But, you know, I think the 1 million SP for the $5 was good. I think that the break came with with the ability to exploit it, you know, buy it multiple times. But that was past. I think this is just a response to a huge amount of outcry from a very select group of people who may or may not have, you know, some Eve fame to them.
Are we talking about the minority again? Like, let's be honest, guys. Like, I have almost 200 million skill points on a character since 2011, right? You guys are probably above that. Like, does 1 million skill points really matter? Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
And for a new player who can take that 1 million further than we could, because a million skill points is nothing for a veteran.
Yeah, right? All this, though, it depends on perspective. It depends on where you're at. So I think I think there's a lot of people who that does mean something to them because it helps them climb into that goal that they've been trying to get to, or it gets them that much closer. It just depends on where you're at. I think a lot of players that are as old in the game as we are aren't fazed by a million HP here or there. But it just depends on where you're at in the game. And for new players, that's big money, but it's also very important for mid players where that's not big money because it gets them a little closer to Logi 5 or it gets them a little closer to the Hulk, you know, optimizing the Hulk mining ship. It depends on where they're at.
Okay, let me put it into another perspective. 1 million skill points is not even enough to level up any cruiser skill from 4 to 5, but it's enough to level up that frigate skill to 4, that gunnery skill to 5, you know, that small guns to 4, and then some specialization and so on and so forth. So
the reason a lot of people get pissed with the skill points, and I don't get pissed because I don't do this, is there's people skill farming and they're running, you know, before they was running skill farms and they want people to buy skill injectors. So when they're giving characters 1 million skill points, they just see that as like a loss of 800 mil to them. Oh, so you get a lot of bitter of it.
State competition, interesting.
But that's another issue though. That's the skill farming issue. I mean,
that's still a one-time charge though.
It's just a one-time thing. Yeah, but it's a one-time multiplied by 200 accounts. Right? We have that one person that I'm not going to say names in talking in stations that clearly publicly said, yeah, I skill farm with 200 and something accounts. So,
but it's that the margins are so small. But before the margins, like people got rich, like seriously, like they made trillions or almost trillions. Or in fact,
They made trillions.
By having 1,000 accounts with ghost farming, and that's why CCP clamped down on it. But now, like when you look at it, skill farming is something you do. To like, you can justify all our activities with, and then skill farm your SP.
Skill farming is just to put the account on stasis, yeah, basically.
Yeah, but there's a lot of people that do like PI and do a lot of other activities that don't justify having a second account, but alongside attributing skill farming to that account, you can sort of justify having it. Like it breaks even, you know what I mean? Like more than paying for, like, you know what I mean, like they can always say like, oh yeah, but I can always sell the skill points that I'm farming. It's like a break even thing. Before it used to make loads, now not so much.
Well, I think that's
nowadays it breaks almost even unless you do like the extraction and you sell your extractor, your injectors at a very specific time in the like fluctuation of the market, you know. Like personally, I've never done skill farming at all. I've looked into it, but I was never interested in having
the margin comes
in micromanaging 200.
But you are skill farming. You just if you have an active account, you're skill farming, right?
Yeah, but I'm not selling that SP.
You're not selling it, but you are
the margin for these things comes from the bulk orders of the extractors. But I think that's really it. It doesn't matter all. I don't
Well, anyway, I do have to go, actually. I'm actually over time now. Apologize. But yeah. This is kind of a fun time zone because look at this nice diversity of new people that we're talking to. So I like this a lot. This is good.
I just came on, Matt. Are you still doing that scam show? Is that going to get recorded?
Yeah, I keep proposing it and my producers keep saying no. So we're fighting it out. It probably won't be this Sunday. I know that you're a scammer and good at it and we want to talk to you. I might do one-on-one interviews with you guys. So it will happen. It just depends on what format it happens, and we'll see. But
I know, I was just paranoid. I was going to miss it because I want to do it.
You will not miss it.
All right, okay. PM me, and then I'll never miss it.
You're on my list, and I only have a list of two people for scamming, so.
Hey, Matterall.
Yeah.
Send me any amount of ISK, knowing I will never give any in return. 100% legit, not a scam.
That sounds about right. we were going to go into some economic stuff and check out if there was anything to look at there. And we're going to do that more often too, Lichgrave. I want to do that more often.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have more time. I would have to go silent and then just kind of...
Nah, it's fine.
So
it's
we could do it at a different time, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. But I want to thank Z-Master. I know you're just a fan, or a super fan, but I love having you on the show because you crack me up. And you're always bringing something interesting to the table.
Thank you.
Yeah. And Minton, it's nice to meet you, Bruler. And Arya, I always like listening to Arya, too. So thanks, Lichgrave, for hanging out with me. And thank you guys for showing up and watching. Go ahead in chat. Tell me if this is a good time zone for you guys to see today and EVE. I mean, the weekend is the busiest time for EVE Online, but it's also for me when I don't do EVE Online. But if you guys like this time slot, let me know.
If you guys want to continue this conversation afterwards, too, we also have the Discord available. We'll be around after the show for you guys to talk about it.
Yeah. So for now, we're going to dump you off into Bjorn B. I would give it to INN. They usually have a show right about now, but I don't think they're on. So I'll give it to Bjorn B and hang out with him for a while. Or come hang out with us in public. We hang out here all weekend.
Yeah, Joe Bain's also doing the 12-hour streams.
Oh, is Joe Bain doing something? Let's go to him.
Mm-hmm.
Joe's a low-sec player. Terrific. Like listening to him.
Great
guy.
PvPer.
All right. Good luck, stability. We'll see you on the other side. Actually, we'll see you tomorrow on Talking in Stations.